Macrolides are a class of antibacterial drugs that, according to their mechanism of action, classify as protein synthesis inhibitor antibiotics. So before their mechanism of action, we have to discuss the pathway of macrolides in our body. When a patient intake macrolides, macrolides come into the stomach and then into the intestine. In intestine, macrolides undergo a partial absorption. So a part of macrolides undergo absorption into the blood, and another portion remains in the intestine. Also, macrolides can be infused directly into the blood by IV infusion. Macrolides in systemic circulation provide the systemic antibacterial effect in various tissues throughout the body, and the macrolides that remain in the intestine provide the intestinal antibacterial effect. Absorption of oral macrolides generally is greater in the fasting state. The reason is that most macrolides are degraded in low pH environment, and as we know, the intake of food stimulates parietal cells to produce hydrochloric acid, and hydrochloric acid causes decrease in intragastric pH, and acidic environment degrades macrolides. Thereby, less macrolides are left for intestinal absorption, so the weaker will be the macrolide systemic and intestinal antibacterial effect. By the way, the only macrolide that is stable in acidic pH is azithromycin. So, in order to increase macrolides absorption, most macrolides should not be administered with food. Because without food, gastric acid production will decrease, thereby pH will be higher. And the higher the pH, the lower is macrolide destruction. Thereby, more macrolides are left for intestinal absorption, thereby the greater will be their systemic and intestinal antibacterial effect. From the organism, macrolides are excreted primarily by the liver. Liver metabolizes macrolides by cytochrome P enzyme and excretes them through the bile. And also the minor portion of macrolides are excreted by the kidneys through the urine. So what is the macrolides mechanism of action? Macrolides inhibit bacterial protein synthesis by binding to the 50S bacterial ribosome. By blocking the function of 50S subunit, they disrupt the translocation phase in protein synthesis. To explain this, we have to know that we have a central dogma in molecular biology, DNA, RNA, protein. Basically, this dogma tells that the genetic information in bacterial DNA has to be copied to RNA molecule and carried to ribosomes where proteins produce. And only proteins can physically provide the function and regulation of the crucial metabolical processes in bacterial homeostasis, as synthesis of the cell wall, for example, or bacterial energy production. To explain this in details, we have to know that DNA molecule is composed of nucleotides that are organized in two strands. First DNA strand called coding strand, and second non-coding strand. And to use this information in the gene, information must be carried to ribosomes where proteins are made. So DNA molecule, for this purpose, makes a copy of the gene in form of prometric RNA molecule. This process called transcription, and transcription is provided by the bacterial DNA-dependent RNA polymerase. And this results in production of prometric RNA molecule. Let's suppose that our sequence of nucleotides located in a coding region that's called exon. So this sequence of nucleotides will not be removed by RNA splicing, and in form of matrix RNA molecule will be delivered to ribosomes. Ribosomes read nucleotide sequence and matrix RNA molecule in codons and include complementary to that codon amino acid. We have to know that in prokaryotes, ribosome is composed of two subunits, 30S subunit and 50S subunit. In eukaryotes, ribosomes composed of 40S subunit and 50S subunit. So they both have 50S subunit. And the molecule that delivers amino acid to ribosome called transfer RNA molecule. Overall, this process called translation, and a particular amount of amino acids form protein. And let's suppose that this protein is an enzyme glyceraldehyde triphosphate dehydrogenase that participates in bacterial glycolysis, and glycolysis is a major source of energy for bacteria. So macrolides bind to 50S ribosome subunit and block it. Thereby, transfer RNA molecule cannot put the amino acid into the amino acid chain, so amino acid chain cannot be further elongated, and without amino acids, protein cannot be formed. So at this moment, protein synthesis completely comes to a halt. So macrolides disrupt bacteria's ability to synthesize proteins. It can be any protein, but because we took a protein that participates in glycolysis, with inability to produce this protein, now glycolysis becomes impossible. Thereby, bacteria will be unable to produce any energy, and energy deficiency disrupts bacteria's ability to grow or to further replicate. This type of impairment makes macrolides bacteriostatic. So generally, macrolides are considered to be bacteriostatic because they only inhibit protein synthesis. But at high doses, they can be bactericidal. Now, because 50S ribosome is present in both prokaryotes and eukaryotes, macrolides are effective against both pro and eukaryotes. This feature makes macrolides a broad-spectrum antibiotic. But they have one interesting feature. They are very effective against gram-positive bacteria and not so effective against gram-negative bacteria. The reason is that in order to affect the bacteria, macrolides have to diffuse through the bacteria membranes inside the bacteria, and only inside the bacteria they can provide the bacteriostatic effect. Macrolides easily diffuse into the gram-positive bacteria and accumulate inside them. But gram-negative bacteria, in contrast to gram-positive bacteria, have a lipopolysaccharide layer, and for macrolides it's very hard to squeeze through this lipopolysaccharide wall. So gram-positive bacteria are more permeable to macrolides and thereby much more vulnerable. And it was estimated that gram-positive bacteria accumulate inside them 100 times more erythromycin compared to gram-negative bacteria. The problem with macrolides is their side effect profile. Macrolides after oral administration can produce GI irritation that in stomach manifests with epigastric burning, nausea and vomiting. In intestine, macrolides stimulate motilin receptor that significantly increase intestinal motility, and this results in high risk of diarrhea and abdominal pain. Because macrolides are incompletely absorbed in the intestine, they can significantly disrupt normal microflora that results in dysbacteriosis. And dysbacteriosis greatly increases the risk of Clostridium difficile infection, so-called pseudomembranous colitis. Also, macrolides have some dangerous extraintestinal side effects. Macrolides can affect cardiac conduction system and cause prolongation of the QT interval in the cardiac cycle. And this significantly increases the risk of cardiac arrhythmias, as torsades de pointes, ventricular tachycardia, and ventricular fibrillation. By the way, torsades de pointes is the most common type of arrhythmia induced by macrolides. Also, macrolides can cause skin allergic reactions, with fever, eosinophilia, and skin eruptions. Usually, they all disappear shortly after therapy is stopped. But sometimes, skin allergic reactions can even progress to Stevens-Johnson syndrome or toxic epidermal necrolysis, which are life-threatening complications. Another side effect is ototoxicity that manifests with tinnitus, vertigo, and loss of hearing. Most patients with hearing loss experience resolution within 1 to 3 weeks after discontinuation of the drug. Because macrolides are metabolized by the cytochrome P enzyme in the liver tissue, macrolides can cause some significant drug interactions. The reason is that cytochrome P enzyme also provides desactivation of numerous drugs, as carbamazepine, cyclosporine, digoxin, warfarin, and many other. And because cytochrome P enzyme metabolizes macrolides, when person intake macrolides, they act as competitive inhibitors of cytochrome P enzyme. Thereby, they inhibit the metabolism of any other drug that is metabolized by this enzyme. As a result, macrolides potentiate the effect of all drugs that are metabolized by cytochrome P. And for example, prolongation of carbamazepine effect can cause some serious consequences. And also because liver tissue provides metabolism and excretion of macrolides, macrolides can cause significant liver injury. And interesting that the factor that provokes liver injury is macrolide structural component acetylate ester. Acetylate ester provokes hypersensitivity reaction in the biliary duct and cause cholestatic pattern of liver injury. Initially, liver injury manifests with abdominal symptoms as nausea, vomiting, and abdominal cramps. Then, after elevation of liver transaminases occurs and jaundice develops. So basically, most of the symptoms mimics acute cholecystitis. And interesting that with cessation of macrolides consumption, all these clinical findings usually resolve within a few days. If you like content, please press like and subscribe button. All the best!